Walking through the door, Mr. Costa?
Part of my philosophy as a director is to sort of get everyone together 10 days or at least a week before, and during the rehearsal process, you become friends, you become partners, you become collaborators, and for me, it's important that everyone feels involved.
There are very few films you have this amazing experience where the director is really nice and everybody's doing so much character study and research into psychopaths, and I thought, it's that great thriller that comes along every once in a while and you're halfway through it and you think you know exactly what's going to happen, and then it just makes all these turns and surprises you.
I always say it's less of a whodunit, but it's also a whydunit, you know? So it's a combination of trying to figure out why the killer has done it and how he's behaving and why he's behaving that way.
It's been a quest.
All right, stand by. Here we go.
I think you're always looking for things within this genre to make it unique. Frankly, every now and then you find a piece of material that you think you can raise the bar.
I think you have to set out with very lofty goals, and you have to set out believing that you have the potential to make something really special. And this is no exception.
Back on action. Ready and action. Ready!
We have a great script that originally was written by John Bokenkamp, who's a fine young writer, and then Hilary Seitz, who wrote Insomnia, came in.
And when Warner Brothers approached me about the script, and before I even read it, I said, well, is anybody interested? And they said, well, Angelina Jolie is. And so having read it, knowing that they could potentially make this movie with her, it was very exciting.
I loved the script and thought, I didn't know what kind of a movie it was going to be. I just wanted to be a part of it and explore it. And now it's actually become this many-layered, very in-depth, very interesting character-driven film.
This had a lot of things going for it. Mark Canton producing the show, Angelina Jolie and Ethan Hawke are two fantastic actors. And so all of those things combined with the script make you start to get excited about, oh, where is this thriller going to really go?
Ethan expressed an interest in making the movie. It seemed like such a great opportunity and such a great chemistry.
You know, it's kind of a classic thriller structure. Well, I was really interested in doing the movie to kind of like the genre.
I saw this man.
We seem to make him very nervous.
Things are not always like they look like, in a movie or in life. That's all about the subject of this movie also. Who is who, really?
It's a wonderful thing about a thriller, is that nothing should be as it seems.
The one thing that I really admire about this piece is that it doesn't just have a twist that is thrown in there because it confuses everybody. It's a very honest movie in that way. So, you know, you do have the thrills, you do have the twist, and at the same time, as you try to figure it out, if you go home and you think back about the movie, it does all make sense.
You want the logic of a movie to make sense and to have it have its own continuity, because it's important if you're teasing people that it has the right payoff.
Because the movie that we wanted to make was a movie that had no holes, no logic gaps. It's a very frustrating experience as an audience member. And you go, well, that doesn't make sense. It takes you out of the movie. We didn't want anybody to have that experience.
We did a huge amount of research with both the FBI and with the profilers and with the people that spend their careers and lives tracking and hunting serial killers.
They were looking for some expertise because they want to do it the way we do it at the Sûreté du Québec.
François has been incredible. You know, he's helped us with the research. He's helped us do things right. We've been able to portray the SQ as accurately as possible for film.
I'm more at ease with murderers, drug dealers, thieves, and now I'm dealing with a movie. Quite a difference in my life.
All right, first position.
Basically, our set is an identical copy of the Sûreté du Québec, which is sort of like the provincial police department that they have there. And so we're dramatically interpreting it, but I want to be as accurate as I can.
I don't understand why he needs to bring in someone else. I mean, we've got everything under control.
Key to this movie, like any good movie, is, you know, a good story well told. And there's not that many tricks here. You know, it's performance and storytelling.
I think it's sort of a crime thriller love story, which is very unique when you start to combine all these genres. And I just want to make sure the actors feel like it's a completely collaborative process, so that when we go off and make the movie, we know exactly where we're going.
Thank you.
The hardest part of directing, I think, is to know, walk in each day and know where you've been and know where you're going in terms of the scene. And DJ is a hard worker. He studies and he comes in prepared.
And then they go like this, and then you can just slowly control.
I like to work, work out a couple things. And so I had those animatics, and I show the studio, particularly one of the intense sequences, and just kind of show them, just to make them feel comfortable. This is the style that the movie that I want to make, and it becomes incredibly helpful.
She focuses on a box that she sees up in the ceiling. Slides the tile back. The body falls.
These animatics or these storyboards help you understand your movie and the scene so much better. By the time I get to a set, I've been over the plans, I know the design, and I know where every key light's gonna be set. I think a good thriller always has mystery and intrigue. But at the same time, you need that anchor of a character, and I believe Angie's character is that anchor. That's someone who's gonna take you through, someone that you like, someone that you trust, someone that you wanna grab onto.
Some directors don't get inside your characters much. They're very focused on the whole plot and where everybody needs to be, but they don't really think, you know, this is where she's nervous or this is what makes him like her.
What does Mr. Agent Scott think about all this?
DJ really understands our characters.
It was important for me to always stay on top of why a certain character was doing what they were doing, and so that you can explain it to the actor. If you don't have that foundation, how can you possibly tell the actor what to do or how to react?
I have confidence because every time I feel something is not there, he's there to, you know, put us back on track or give us an idea just to get away from what we did before to find something new, you know. He's really a good director.
Great. Yeah, very good. Thank you, Jakey. Good work.
He has real passion and real integrity as a person. And I don't know, you know, you can tell when somebody really wants to make a good movie. You know, they're really willing to put the thought and time into it. And he certainly is.
DJ has a very strong sense of where he wants to go with the picture and a very strong point of view about each individual character and how they're going to interact. And ultimately, that vision is what becomes the film.
I'm not sure what I see in you yet with all your tricks.
DJ allows the actors to try what they need to try, and they'll try what he wants to try so that we arrive at the best possible scene.
There's a really vital scene that takes place on the elevator between Jenna Rollins and one of the characters, and to me that was a really, really tough scene.
Hello, mother.
Because this transformation has to happen with Jenna, and she has to realize that her son has now maybe confronted her on this elevator, and just the performance elements of that were very interesting, because seeing your son, have not seen him in 19 years and believe that he's dead, it presents a lot of challenge. There are a lot of things you do with cameras and lingering things or cameras back in the corner looking through some foreground and just getting the sense that someone might be in that room or even leading the audience to a sort of a false focus, like Angelina might be focusing on something up there when really she should be focusing on something that's behind her. There's nothing more effective than just a nice close-up of an actor whose eyes shift. If you have the audience and the movie's working, a look or a shift or something could mean something that might necessarily, you know, something that might go by in a normal movie in a thriller can mean something scary is about to happen. Particularly with Angelina's character, I did a lot of extreme close-ups of one eye or two eyes. It was just a way that I found it helped me kind of get inside her head. So those are, I mean, they're not any new tricks, but those are sort of the tried and true tricks of the genre.
Special Agent Scott?
Yes.
I think what I try to do is let the emotion of what the actor and the scene is about help dictate the shot.
There's a sequence where Angelina's in the hospital and she sees Mrs. Asher, and Mrs. Asher's just identified the body and sort of sends Ileana spinning. And you'll see there's a shot that we do, a 360 spin coming down the stairwell with Ileana that's, you know, emotionally representing where she is at that time. And I think that DJ's really tapped into that, into finding these locations that represent, you know, where the character is at the time.
aquí tus trailers.
Our final sort of showdown is about 4.5 minutes. And about 3.5 minutes of it's like it's completely quiet with no music and two people talking. And if your movie's not working, it would be probably incredibly frightening to have to sit there for 3.5 minutes. But when we get to this final scene, you realize that you cannot hear a thing. Not one ounce, not one word, not one cough. It's just completely quiet because you've gotten the audience to a place where they're captivated and they want to see what's going to happen. That's really exciting as a filmmaker, you know, to scare the shit out of the audience. It's fantastic. The thing about making a movie, it's a marathon. You wake up every day and you shoot the movie, you go to dailies, you know, after dinner, and next thing you know, it's midnight and you got a call at 7. It's just a cycle that never ends, so you really have to pace yourself. You know, you really have to keep focused. You don't have a lot of time to look back. It's all about being going forward and what's next and what's next.
Everything you saw, I wanted you to see.
Is under the department's protection, but that doesn't mean we can just go in and search it.
What about a headstrong FBI agent who's just not familiar with those roles?
Yeah, I was lucky. I was very lucky. I was blessed. It's a really, really good cast. I just wanted to make sure that it was still an actor's piece, even though it was in this sort of thriller genre. With Ethan and Angie and Kiefer, there was so much there for them to do.
These are people that are choosing to be really great actors. And in this case, each one of them did their research to understand these characters and ask the questions and push the writing and push the producers, push the director to really take the characters to the next level.
You give them just something, just a little gem or just a nugget, or you adjust one of the other actors and the way that they react, it's really like an open discussion. And not only do you know your character, but you get to know the other person's character, and you can play one actor against the other, and they all came to play.
No. Have you ever been fishing? Huh? The bait always dies.
Angelina's always seemed like the perfect person to be in this movie. She seems like somebody who can walk into the room and see more than is there.
I thought this is a character that would have her voice and her mannerisms and be a lot closer to her than some of the previous characters she's played in the past couple years.
I didn't want to play a just really confident, perfect, smart woman who came in and just had the answers to everything. I wanted to play somebody who was very flawed.
Angelina's character is a character who, by the nature of being a profiler, is very shut down.
And that's what's interesting about Ileana, is that for Ileana to be great at what she does, she has to cut herself off from the rest of her life to enable her to do her job.
She's one of the few actors that I've watched that can be incredibly quiet and have 1,000 things going on at the same time. So this role was perfect.
I've always joked that she plays the, you know, leading man and I play the femme fatale.
And he's a very good femme fatale.
In a way he is. He's a little bit dangerous, he's a little bit mysterious, he's very vulnerable.
There's a depth and there's a darkness and there's a certain kind of mystery about this character that I haven't seen him play that I really am enjoying, and I think he's great and I think it suits him.
You looked at him and you saw me.
My kind of take on performance has always been one kind of rooted in a first-person kind of narrative where I relate to this guy, I'm gonna play him. And I don't get this character at all, and I don't relate to him at all. And that's been really interesting for me.
I thought it would be great to put him in this role because this character had to be everything. He had to be incredibly intelligent. When he witnesses something that's so horrific that he tries to overcome, and at the same time, he has this physical attraction to Angelina's character, and I just thought Ethan has the depth to kind of put all that together.
You've been great.
You're making me sound nicer than I am.
Kiefer's role is not in as much of the movie, but I knew that if we didn't get somebody good to play that part, the movie would never work. It kind of pivots on that role.
With Kiefer, there's a sense of menace. He doesn't have to raise his voice. He seems on screen so much bigger, so much more physical than he is because there's so much going on inside of him.
We When you get into playing a character based on ambiguity, it can be a lot of fun, especially if you get to steer them away from the truth here and a bit there. That's fun, yeah.
Setting the movie in Montreal gave me an opportunity to get really good French actors and the real thing. So I got Olivier Martinez and Jean-Yves Anglade and Jackie Carrier, who are three of my favorite French actors.
In a way, we are discovering the story day after day, you know? I didn't want to play too much a stereotype of a cop, so DJ is very open to our suggestions.
The character of Jean-Yves Anglade, Duval, it's a bit the opposite of my character, and I think we're like a couple. He's more phlegmatic and I'm more nervous. So Duval is his best and only friend, because this is the only guy who is able to support him.
It's a good team, you know. Their energy is very different. There is one discreet, the other one is a bit more outside. It's interesting, you know. They can play bad and good. They can have a good interaction.
She's just going to be advising, right?
This isn't about territory, Bucket.
There hasn't been a murder like this in years. Okay, and the first thing you're gonna do is bring in someone else. Come on.
I have a strange feeling about this murder.
And then, of course, the icing on the cake is Jenna Rowland. I mean, she's a legend for the right reason, you know?
She was really the most surprising actor. The way that she stepped up and took the darkness of her part and carried it underneath the sweetness that she portrays, I thought was really intriguing and interesting.
Well, we just talked generally what we thought, and we agreed so much that there really wasn't any place to argue about. It just, it's a very well-written script, and your duties towards it are very specific.
I think what was important for me was that we maintained a level of what I could sort of call character integrity. The reason I choose or do a project is because I love the story, and the actors that I choose to be in the story are people that I admire. And in this film, we had this incredible, incredible cast lined up, and there's interesting roles.
I know you've seen this picture on the news, Mrs. Asher, but if you could just take a closer look at it, please.
This was a female character, and this was a female's movie, and I thought also important to have a female editor, you know, to help with that voice.
This was a very character-driven film. It's about a killer's mind and the FBI agent's mind, and it's about interesting characters. And I would say that my work is somewhat character-driven or actor-driven in that way.
Depending on the scene, there might be a moment where the actor is incredibly compelling and good, but at the same time, it's not propelling your story forward. So how long do you hang on this moment? Is this moment vital?
And you usually cut the scene for what it's worth when you first cut it, you know, not allowing necessarily for where the performance is going to go. So you know you're going to have to go back in at a later date and change it a little bit. Then later on, when you get it all together and you see where her performance went, you go back into the earlier scenes and you alter things to suit where the performance is going later on.
Even the simplest scene maybe should be shot or played two or three different ways, because you want to be able to have control over how they behave in the editing room so that you can have this option or this option.
Only Martin reached the shore. That must have been devastating for you.
It was. The first thing that you think about is what story are you telling, and then you start thinking about the suspense and the thrills and, you know, putting in the excitement.
People with thrillers and crime thrillers and in that genre, they have a certain expectation, and so it was a fine line balancing the drama, how long to hang on certain things, what to pace.
A lot of cutting is rhythm, so though you can go from one place to another or cut within the scene all over, you've got to have a certain rhythm.
Something that you thought was going to be incredibly special, or something that you compose and you figure, God, this is going to be the shot, and then you realize you really can't stay in the shot that you composed for the majority of the scene as long as you want, because once you get into a certain cut-in pattern, that shot no longer holds.
Sometimes cut it several times and it's not working because it should be working, and then you get the right moment. When we saw the Kiefer character give that wave, he used to drop a glass with a crash. and then they would all start running around. But it had a lot more of that suspense tension of longer shots. Now we've cut it quite quickly and you get there very quickly. And it makes sense, because once she sees a Kiefer character, he obviously looks like a suspect. So how long can you hold her before she would react? So, you know, there were two ways of looking at that, and that was quite interesting. I thought you could kind of hold it. It's only because we know it's Kiefer Sutherland that we think she should react. But to my mind, she could have held back a little bit and been suspicious of him, but not moving on him immediately. It's exciting. That's why I love cutting.
It's interesting because we have different styles, which is good. You know, she might like something that I hate, or I might hate something that she likes. But ultimately, at the end of the day, there has to be one decision that's made. You know, if you're empowered, and I was, thank God, in this movie, that it's ultimately going to be your decision. So you're either going to sink or swim with it. You know?